I'm going to ask a couple things of you guys. The first thing is, I want as much energy as I give back. I hurt myself really bad the other day. I cracked my rib, but I'm still going to fucking give 100%. So please give it right back to me. But for the love of God, for the love of God, I'm not even religious, but for the love of God, don't grab my shoulder or I'm going to scream like a three-year-old girl. All right. This guy's going to do the first stage dive. I need people to catch him. We're a hardcore band. We're a straight-edge band.
I mean, sadly, in the end, this kind of is the thing that really tore the band apart, but I'm not interested right now in my life in being in a hardcore band that's not a straight-edge band. People always throw this around like, you know, just another straight-edge band. You know, the world doesn't need another straight-edge band. Right, the world doesn't need another straight-edge band. Because only 90% of the world is telling you that the way that you should live your life is by drinking, doing drugs, that this is the acceptable way of expressing yourself. That if you have social problems, the way to change that is to use alcohol or drugs as a social lubricant. That if you are feeling bad about your life, the way that you should cover that up is by getting drunk or stoned.
I've been really good friends with Aram since like 5 or 6 years, and we always wanted to do a hardcore band together.
Betrayed, really, it just came together by Todd had been playing Carry On for a long time, and Carry On was, you know, one of my all-time favorite bands, like one of the most important bands to me. So, and I'd been playing a Champion, and we were really, really good friends over the years.
In September of 2004, I flew up to Seattle to check out Champion's record release show for Promises Kept, and I wasn't doing anything at the time, and he just recorded his record, Promises Kept, so we both had some free time to do some stuff, so we decided then was the right time to do a band together, so we started Betrayed. Betrayed, a lot of people say that Betrayed's like a melodic hardcore band, and like when we started the band, we wanted to sound like Minor Threat and Dag Nasty and have a, you know, have a bit of melody like Dag Nasty has. And I've never done a band like that before, and I have a lot of fun doing it. I have a lot of fun writing songs like that, making songs like with a touch of melody, and I like doing Betrayed. It's fun.
We were always just kicking around the idea of about starting a band because everywhere we turned, it just seemed like all these bands that were about nothing.
Guys, please, don't let this moment slip away. I feel like I'm more and more so getting alone out in the world because I still see people slipping away. I'm not talking about straight edge, I'm just talking about the idea that this scene that we have is something that helps us deal with the outside world. That these values and these beliefs aren't from 15 to 22. They can last from 15 to 91 if you make sure you're realistic. The idea isn't for me to have a scene. The idea for me is to have a community.
Yeah, this is Aram's first band he sang in, and he's played guitar in Champion and a few bands before that. He's never sang in a band, you know, we just decided, hey, we'll do a band together. Aram wanted to sing, I wanted to play guitar. We didn't think when we recorded our record that it was going to be, we thought it was I personally thought it was probably going to be pretty mediocre. I just wanted to do it just to, you know, have a nice documentation of my friendship with Aram and have fun.
If I'm going to put my time and my energy and my passion into being in a band, it's going to be one voice in that 10% saying, nah, you know, you don't have to do these things. And I'm not trying to start, like, you know, raise some straight-edge army. I'm just trying to make sure people know there's a choice. Because where I grew up and the way I grew up, I didn't feel there was a choice. I never even thought about it because growing up in the middle of Alberta, you just drank and you did drugs. That's what you did when you were a teenager, you know? Like, that's just how it was. And when I started getting a little older and I realized, you know, hey, I don't need this, I felt totally, like, I felt betrayed. As funny as it sounds, I felt betrayed because all these people have been telling me, you know, this is what you do.
Yeah, the first record on Bridge 9, it's called Addiction. It's 6 songs. We recorded that record in Seattle in October of 2004, and before I went up there to go record it with those guys. We thought we wanted to sound like Dag Nasty and Minor Threat and have a very early 80s hardcore approach to our songs. So I wrote some songs. I used GarageBand. It's software on, I believe, on Mac computers. It's awesome software. And basically I wrote songs, laid down drums, and recorded the guitar over those, and made MP3s and sent them to Aram, and he wrote vocals, lyrics over them. We recorded the record, and we played our first show in June of 2005 in San Diego with Champion.
The specific idea for Betrayed came up. Just like all these bands with all of this urgency and all of these, like, you know, powerful feelings, but about nothing. Like, well, I don't know what anyone was talking about. Everyone just seemed to have these, like, we care, we care, we care, but no one ever said what they cared about. And just getting frustrated with music, getting frustrated with hardcore. And I never really thought it was going to happen until, you know, one day he was just like, hey, you know, I'm going to send you an MP3. I wrote a bunch of songs. And when I first heard those songs, it was seriously as if he'd gone into my head, taken out everything I would have liked to do, like, do musically, and then put it into a song. I was totally blown away. I had to leave for tour with Champion for like 3 months, so I didn't record the vocals for about 3 months. I put a lot of thought into the lyrics about what I wanted to say, why I wanted to say them, what I thought was important. Some of the experiences on that tour, like, it was like, you know, winter in Europe when we were on tour, and it was freezing cold. Just like my whole mindset about everything. When I approached those vocals, I felt totally centered and wrote them out and suffered through them, you know, because it was the first time I'd ever really sang in a hardcore band. And I couldn't have been happier with it. And then after that, you know, we just started, you know, doing shows, put out a couple other records.
I like when he talks between songs. You know, I've heard a lot of people say that, oh, the singer of Betrayed talks too much in between songs. But, you know, I think what Aram says is very, very important. I think people should hear it, and I think people should talk about it.
All I really want is for people to realize, like, yo, you have this choice, and you need to question the things that are going on around you. Like, don't look for answers in other people. Find your own answers, because those are the only ones that are going to matter, like, you know, in a year or 5 years or 10 years. And when people listen to Betrayed, I just want them to be able to say, like, okay, this is a guy that's like, you know, he lived a life where he's trying to figure stuff out for himself, and this is a document of that. And, you know, maybe I can take something from it, but what I should take from it is the strength to go find my own answers.
I feel that the production on the album is awesome. I love it. I think Kurt Ballou did a great job. I don't think that we've accomplished everything that I wanted to accomplish on the record. It's kind of hard to explain, but I think that the record doesn't have enough focus. It's not focused enough on one particular thing to really make the biggest impact we could have made, at least musically.
This song is about my brother here. It's about addiction. No matter how bad it gets, I fucking understand.
Again, that's like one of those things. I think that LP was kind of the beginning of the end for Betrayed, in the sense that, you know, we had this real, just, you know, whatever, let's go. Todd would do his thing musically, and I would do my thing lyrically, and we just, like, we're both full of, like, this is what I'm going to do, and neither one of us really crossed into the other one, you know? We might have a couple suggestions here and there, but Substance, we were trapped in Salem for 2 weeks, freezing cold, snowing, you know? And we didn't have a lot of songs going into the session. So Kurt Ballou, like, you know, helped out, produced a lot. And I back all those songs. They're awesome songs. I love the lyrics. I love everything about that record. But the one thing I'll say is that's when I knew that there was going to be a problem, because that's when Todd and I really started having a lot of issues about having a different vision. You know, he really doesn't want to be in a straight-edge band. He's really very much more of the, like, I've been there, I've done that. And, you know, you got to respect that, because the guy was in one of the most important straight-edge bands of, you know, the past decade, then, you know, a really significant band. I can understand that, but that's when we start getting arguments about lyrics, songs, and ideas, and kind of, like, what we wanted to put forth in the band. But I think it was cool, because in the end, we came together with a record that neither of us was expecting. Like, songs that I never would have thought, you know, that I would have written necessarily. I covered some topics that I was pretty, like, I went in not thinking I was going to cover these songs and these topics and cover them. And you know, I felt good about it, actually, because it challenged me a lot lyrically. It challenged how I was going to sing on some tracks. You know, Kurt did a great job. Like, I was really happy, like, putting together that record was a struggle, but it was cool. I was really happy with it in the end. You know, Todd and I obviously, like, made the decision to end the band. For me, it was, like, one of the hardest things, you know, because Betrayed is definitely, like, what I felt with my boys. Like, Champion, you know, Champion was my time. Like, I'll never forget those days, but Betrayed was where I felt, this is my voice. This is my time to speak about the things that are important to me. I cherished every moment, and I'm really sad that the band's going to be broken up. I feel a loss over this band that I probably haven't felt over any band that I've been in that broke up. We'll see what next project I come up with. Hopefully it will be something good. You just got to keep going forward, man. And we've got a couple last shows. I'm pretty excited about them. Because I don't want people to come to these shows and have it be like, this is it. This is the last show for Betrayed. You know, like, oh my God. I want people to come to this show and be like, this is a hardcore show. And tomorrow, there might be another hardcore show. And the week after that, there'll be another hardcore show. And not so much having a focus on, like, the band, but have a focus on the fact that this was a band that was a part of something, and that thing still exists, and that thing is more important than any one band that's a part of it. If I made one person question anything, then awesome. I did, you know, I did what I wanted to do.
Been into horror movies since I was a little kid, and you know, not like so much slasher stuff, but older stuff like Universal Horror, like black and white stuff. And this is my toy collection. These are the toys that represent my life. From my childhood, when I was a kid, I used to collect all the Aurora models from like the 60s, and then the big thing for me was the Munsters, which is right here. When I was a kid, life revolved around the Munsters. And the Addams Family to some degree, but it was all about the Munsters for me. The other thing that I was really into as a kid was Planet of the Apes. And there's just some Planet of the Apes stuff there. I want to show you something. This is the bass I played pretty much from the beginning of time. I was played with this band in SSD and Slapshot, and the reason I'm showing you this is because I've heard more than once people have said, oh, I bought Jamie's bass on eBay or some, and people have said that they own this bass, and this is the only bass that I ever played, and I still own it to this day. So if you think you own it, you don't. Right?
Last fucking show ever. So I was talking to my friend Slam the other night. And I said, Slam, you're the fucking most straight-ass guy I know.
Oh, thanks, sweet Pete, for inviting me down to I just want to say one thing, okay? We're playing an old song, but it's not to encourage people to go out and kick people's ass when they didn't play it. This is the whole point of what causes me to do that. Listen, when you become straight edge, you're going against the grain of the way the whole world moves. People are going to cast you, they're going to make fun of you, and they're going to discourage you. So this is what you can tell.
Porcell's a positive.
That was freaking, that was another phenomenon, because I looked out there. I mean, first of all, it was the weirdest show to me, because, I mean, now Straight Edge is like a little bigger again. But it seemed to me at that time that Straight Edge was real like on a like downturn. And I didn't really, you know, hear or see any, you know, that much about Straight Edge. And I got to that show and there was like 800 Straight Edge kids under one roof. And I was like, man, this is freaking nuts. So Sweet Pete asked me to do it, you know, so I came down to do it, and I did it because, you know, I'm good friends with him. So I remember that Sweet Pete handed me the mic, and kids were freaking moshing before the song even started, and like I was just like talking, and I wanted to say a little something about, you know, how the song did, you know, wasn't, you know, about, you know, meant to, you know, make people go out and, you know, beat the crap out of each other. It was sort of meant as a, you know, release for, you know, kids that, you know, took shit for being straight edge. And so I started talking and I looked out and there's like pits forming and like kids just like, you know, you could tell that something was gonna go off when the song started.
I met Capo, actually Capo and Purcell. The first day I moved to New York, they were Youth of the Day and Bold was playing at Stevie's, and I met those guys then. Started hanging out with them and got to be friends with all those guys.
Al Brown was he was my roommate when we lived in Williamsburg in Brooklyn. We called it Schism HQ because that's where we ran Schism out of. When he lived in Iowa, he did this scene called Love Seat. He wanted to continue doing it. And I really wanted to write some stuff and interview some people too, so we decided just to do it. We, you know, we called it Schism. Schism is what Ray Bees used to call Krishna neck beads. But he was sort of on the Christian tip. And so he was always a little wary of Krishna, so he would always go, yo man, don't wear them beads, man. There's schism in them beads, bro. Yo, there's schism in them beads, bro. So we used to get a kick out of it, so we decided to name the zine Schism. And so it was sort of a big deal, and like me and Al were, you know, collaborating on this, and people were kind of psyched about it.
Love Seat was much more like arty kind of fanzine, and Schism ended up being, you know, more of a kind of New York scene, straight edge scene, zine.
Let's do this fanzine about the hardcore scene, like a straight edge fanzine, like this is what we're into. Let's do a fanzine. Alex was really into like photography and writing, and Purcell was into writing, and, you know, like, I think they wanted to do it, and I thought they felt the best way to launch it was to have some sort of an EP inside of it, and, you know, that might have sparked the whole thing.
What we wanted to do is we wanted to make the first issue, like, really special, and so we were like, we gotta put a 7-inch in it, we gotta put a 7-inch in it, but none of the bands at the time really had, like, any, you know, unreleased material. You know how it is when you're sitting around in, you know, the bedroom with a bunch of your friends and, you know, you just start talking about crazy ideas. We came up with this idea. Yo, we're going to do the freaking ultimate straight edge band. We'll record it at Don Fury's. We'll press a single real quick. We'll have fake names. It'll be freaking awesome. And so it was just one of those sort of crazy ideas that actually became reality.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that I really remember why we did it. I think it was just, you know, just kind of a cool thing that we wanted to do for the fanzine, to have a 7-inch in there to be included with the zine, and I don't know, it was just kind of fun to do a band that nobody knew about. We did it in semi-secrecy.
And we called up Walter and Sammy, and we got them to do it, and we literally practiced like maybe 3 times.
So it's Porcell, myself, Walter, that played bass in Youth Today and played guitar in Gorilla Biscuits and a bunch of bands, and Alex Brown, he played in Gorilla Biscuits and Side by Side with me. We were all friends and we played in these bands. And I don't know what inspired it initially, but I know Porcell was like, I'm going to be Slam, like Slam, you know, and maybe it was just his way of like hiding behind something to, you know, because I think singing for a band is not the easiest thing, so it's like, I had to maybe make up this alias. I don't know what it was. He's Slam.
Slam actually came from that song by Decadence, I don't know, on that Boston But Not LA comp. It was John Nassus's first band. And that song, you gotta slam, gotta slam, gotta slam, gotta slam. So I always loved that song, so I call myself Slam.
And ND was for Walter. And shit, I can't remember what that stood for. It was, it wasn't No Direction. It was something that we were cracking on him for always being late and being kind of a space cadet.
Walter's an awesome dude, but he's always like notoriously late. So ND, we told him it meant no diving, which was like, because everyone was getting banned from stage diving all these clubs all around New York, and it was just becoming a real pain in the ass. And it was like, dude, like no diving, you know, that's gonna be your name.
When we were thinking of names, we told him he was ND for no drugs, but it actually meant not dedicated because he never showed up to any of the practices. Sammy was a youth because he was probably like 14 years old or something at the time.
I think Porcell originally was Kid Hard, but I ended up adopting that moniker. Porcell is, what was he, Scream or?
Slam.
Slam. That's fucking hilarious.
Alex Brown was Kid Hard, which was like, you know, Kid Hard or like borderline. Sounds like a porno star name of some sort.
I don't know where the hell Kid Hard came from, but and we actually got Project X from that stupid movie, the Matthew Broderick movie. I think like Al Brown had rented it or something. He was like, we gotta call the band Project X. So it actually did come from that movie.
It had nothing to do with that. It was my idea, but I've never even seen that movie, so I don't know where he would have gotten that from. I don't know. You know, shit, what was that done, I don't know, 15 years ago at least. My memory of it is thinking that it was just kind of a cool name for something that was to be secretive, that fit the band's MO pretty well.
I remember Porcell talking to me about this idea that him and Alex had and what they wanted to do, and I think that was before they had done anything but talk about it. I think maybe they'd come up with their names at that point, and that was about it.
I kind of felt Youth of Today was going soft. They used to have a song that I used to really be into, We Just Might. Come drunk to a show, looking for a fight, head for the dance floor, something, something, We Just Might.
It was done about the same time as We're Not In This Alone, which I think Ray was trying to expand his vocal horizons.
At some point, probably after we recorded the record, Went On This Alone, I think Ray was probably thinking about doing this band Shelter. I knew that Porcell wanted to do this project where he wanted to sing, and he wanted to do this like really full-on, super straight edge, like this is something that we're into. And the lyrics were fully like, you know, I'm as straight as the lines that you sniff up your nose, like I'm as hard as the blues that you're swilling. It was like is full on, like, I'm so fucking straight edge, like, check this out.
Love is strength, as a vine, that just sniff up your nose. And love is hard, as a boom, that just will down your throat. And love is bad, as a shit, you breathe into your throat. And I'll fuck you up as bad, as a pill, on your tongue.
Straight Edge Revenge actually used to be a Youth Today song that was written by this dude, Rat Boy, that lived in Connecticut. He also wrote the lyrics to Youth Crew.
This time you push me too far.
So that kind of set the tone for it. So from there it was like, all right, you know, let's get a couple more songs. We'll do like this EP and we'll record it. We'll put it out. It'll be this really cool thing. Play a few shows. It'll be fun.
I remember recording in the winter, I think it was probably like around New Year's, 87, 88, where we recorded at Don Fury's.
The band did everything, you know, pretty much live, I think. I don't think there's like, I think Al Brown might have went in and done a second guitar track or something, but we did it real quick.
Let's see, we had Dylan, Mike Judge, maybe Chris, like, we had like three or four friends doing backup, but I remember when it came out, Ray was really pissed that he that he A, didn't know about it, and B, that he was not asked to do the backup vocals on it. And I think that we didn't ask him because he had such a big mouth that he would have told everybody about it.
You know, we pressed it up, and we, you know, me and Al just had them all. They were all test pressings with the big holes. And I think we only had 500 pressed.
Me and Porcelli wrote all the labels. We wrote them by hand.
You know, we stapled them into the Schism zine. I'd say like over 300 of them were sold at this one show, one bold show at the Anthrax in 1988. All the ones that we sold at the Anthrax, we wrote things on the labels. And I think the rest of like the other 200 or so, or 100 or so, we stamped them. And it's always funny when I go to a kid's house, and I'll be like, yeah, you got the Project X EP? You know, if the person's got a good record collection, they'll be like, yeah, and I'll open it up and I'll just see like all the funny crap we wrote on the labels.
The pressing was so awful that they were just these thin, thin, thin records. And the only copy that I have to this day is smashed into about 5 pieces. Kind of broke because it's so cheaply made. I have all these bootleg copies, but those are kind of worthless to me.
I know a song called Shutdown, which was based on the whole no diving thing, which was pretty much the Shutdown show where at CBGB's, I think it was Youth Today and maybe Gorilla Biscuits and a bunch of bands.
Sick of things the way they are? It's about time that we had a change!
Side by Side played, we had a really cool set. It was just fucking packed out matinee. People were totally psyched. It was the last band that played, and I think it was Youth of Today. Yeah, stage was so packed with people, stage diving or whatever, that they were like packed almost to the ceiling. We had been told by Hilly Crystal, the owner, had told us explicitly that, you know, there was to not be any stage diving, and they might have had like extra security and stuff, and they just got bum rushed basically when the New York band started playing.
But Youth Today didn't even say anything. We just played the show, and whatever, the bouncers couldn't control it, and it was nuts. And I mean, it was an incredible show. The owner for CB's came out afterwards. You guys freaking are never playing here again. You're banned. Every band you guys are in is, you know, completely banned. And we were just like, whatever, we just got up there and played, you know, it's your fault, you should have hired, you know, more bouncers or something. And it was weird because I went to CB's every freaking week for years. Every Sunday I was at CBGB's, you know, and after that I couldn't get in anymore. I don't think I went to CBGB's for probably like, you know, a year, maybe 2 years or something. So it really freaking pissed me off. You know, I supported CBGB's. I gave them my money. You know, we played there for, you know, barely any money. And, you know, we sort of got slapped in the face for it.
And I geez at the door.
The last line, I think, of Shutdown is, or else you'll be as lame as the fucking Ritz. And the Ritz was like total like big business kind of like bouncer, you know, like you get like all sorts of mixed kind of knuckleheads coming to shows, and there's always fights and the problem.
Yeah, the Ritz was their first show, even though they made fun of the Ritz, or they said the Ritz was lame in one of the songs.
I think the first show was at one of those hardcore Super Bowl. It was like Super Bowl of hardcore at the Ritz, the old Ritz, which is on 11th Street. And we got on the bill, I think, last minute, and got up, played. And the thing with the Ritz is like when you played, it was like, okay, you know, the guy that ran it, I think it was Chris Williamson, was like, you know, just, you've got no time, you're lucky to be here, just get up and play. And it was seriously like 10 or 15 bands playing in one afternoon.
I remember I was playing Porcell's guitar. He had that black Les Paul, and it had like a loose input for the guitar chord. And so first chord of the show, I like jumped off the drum riser and landed, and the fucking chord fell out. And I was like fumbling around. I think I might have fallen too. And I was too like nervous on stage to realize that, to wrap the cord around the guitar strap so that it wouldn't fall out. So for the whole show, the fucking thing kept falling out, and we had an awful show.
I'm sure it sounded like shit. We were probably loose and nervous, and playing the Ritz was like a big deal. It's like a big place, like a real stage and everything. And where I just remember Alex Brown, A.K.A. Kid Hard, jumping on the drum riser and sliding across the drum riser, like on his back. It just looked so fucked up from where I was. But it was cool. It was all like, you know, just energy, you know what I mean? And we were going for it.
The judge! It's called Dance Floor Justice.
We drove, you know, down to see the first Super Bowl of hardcore. We, you know, I think I had a job, and so we had to drive, like, you know, super fast out of Deconic to get there in time to see him, and I saw him, and I was psyched for it, but then, you know, Alex Brown, I think he broke his guitar on the first note of the first song, so it was fun, and me and my friends danced around, but it, you know, it sounded like crap, and I just thought it was because Alex broke his guitar, but I pretty much think every time I saw him, they sounded like crap. Just thought it was a thing, but it was fun to see Porcell sing.
So I remember being surprised at Porcell, you know, how crazy he would go when he was singing.
I just remember, like, it was intense, like, seeing Porcell sing. Was cool. Like, he had that whole, like, he'd rock the construction gloves, you know. So he had this, like, just screamy, you know, just like his own voice.
We only have two more songs. That's all we know. It is a really real band.
I mean, we never planned on it being a real band. I mean, it was just supposed to be that 7-inch that was just supposed to, you know, be like a cool extra thing in the fanzine. It was basically just to promote the fanzine. It wasn't to be a band at all. We had no plans whatever of playing any shows.
Ethan today is not playing tonight because Ray's got to do the vocals for a new record tomorrow and he didn't want to fuck up his voice. So Project X and Judge are playing. You.
It was weird because the response to the 7-inch was like really good and people really wanted to see the bands. People were like, you know, bugging us about, you know, playing shows and stuff, and we were like, wow, man, this is pretty cool. We should just like play some shows. So we did actually end up playing like a handful of shows. I can't remember exactly how many. We played one at the Ritz.
And showed the Lismar Lounge, which was this little place over here on Avenue A. Back in Avenue A was real sketchy, and it was how do we play with it? It was cool. The ceiling was really low, and I remember just kids going nuts and like kicking the ceiling was falling apart. And that was a fun show.
We played either one or two with the Anthrax. Those shows were great. then we actually played a couple of times in Europe, because Youth Today was on tour in Europe in 1989. And we were touring with this other band, Lethal Aggression, who were like these freaking dirtbag dudes from New Jersey. I don't know where they found that band. They were, you know, just like alcoholic dudes, like, you know, crazy freaking, you know, punk guys. And so they ended up getting drunk and like beating up the tour manager, so they got kicked off the tour. And we didn't really want them on the tour either, so they were like, look, we have to have two bands on the tour, can you guys just make up a band? I was like, maybe we could do Project X. So we did Project X for a couple of shows.
Alex wasn't there, so I think Walter probably played guitar and Jordan Cooper from Revelation played bass. He couldn't play bass at all, but he pretty much just like, I think he wrapped his head up in a towel and just kind of came out, and we probably turned him down to like one. And it's pretty much guitar, drums, and Purcell screaming our short Project X set.
Because we got the Swami over here on bass, and he doesn't really know the song, so we're only going to play two songs.
They taught me, I think, they taught me three of the songs on bass, and I only really remembered one of them, so I just turned the volume off as soon as the song I remembered was over, and I just faked the rest of the set.
So him and Walter used to dress up in like these weird things for the shows. Like Jordan would put on like a turban or something. Walter had this like aviator's cap. And so, I don't know, it was just kind of funny.
A friend of mine, Sid, let me borrow his scarf, and I just wrapped it around my face and everything. And they called me the Swami.
Actually did play a couple of shows with us. He was our roadie on tour. It's so bizarre to me that the band was even heard outside of like New York or Connecticut. And I tell you, it was so weird. The first time we did it was in Belgium. So we're in Belgium. I mean, we had done this record like probably less than a year before. We only pressed 500 of them. 300 of them were sold in Connecticut at one show. We played the show, I was like, who the hell is gonna know freaking Project X? Play this freaking show. The whole crowd knew the words to every song. I couldn't believe it. And it was just like so weird. I mean, that's when I started to realize that like the whole Straight Edge Revenge thing sort of became like a real kind of cult thing that people just got into and just got emotionally attached to it somehow. It was strange how it just kind of like spread, you know? You know, it was, I wouldn't say a joke. It was definitely like tongue in cheek, but the ounce of seriousness in it was that we were really freaking into Straight Edge. It was something we really believed in.
It was tongue. I think we were just covering our asses because it was like kind of militant stuff. To say that it was tongue in cheek, but I don't know. I mean, you know, I mean, Straight Edge Revenge. Are you fucking kidding me? Or Dance for Justice? I mean, it was kind of like the, you know, just like ultimate Straight Edge fantasy.
You had to really understand what was going on at the time in the scene. Like, it was sort of the time when the scene was starting to become divided. Straight Edge pretty much, like, peaked in 1988, and then even, like, towards the end of, like, 1988, a lot of people were, you know, going against it, and a lot of people who were really into it were starting to get really out of it, and they were getting really critical of people who were Straight Edge, and, you know, if you were, like, 20 years old and still Straight Edge, you were considered like, yo, come on, man, you're something you're supposed to grow out of or whatever. So even though those sentiments got really bad later, even during that time, it was pretty bad. So it was sort of in reaction to that whole thing.
It's hard to be Straight Edge. You know, the whole world basically isn't Straight Edge. So the fact that you got to rally around some stupid slogan or stupid ideal, that's not the freaking worst thing in the world. It got people into it, you know, people that wanted to, kids that wanted to have fun. It was fun crawling across people's heads with the anthrax and you know, shouting out things that really, like, are basically pretty ridiculous.
When I first heard it, like, you hopefully take it tongue-in-cheek. You know, it's fun, it's, you know, it's what it's supposed to be, just fun, fast hardcore, like, lyrics that, you know, you would hope are taken tongue-in-cheek, but, you know, obviously some people didn't take it as such.
I guess what has been interesting about all that stuff and definitely about Project X is through the years, people definitely interpret it in different ways. You know, people seem to take it like to the extreme and like really literal, like I'm gonna fuck you up as fast as a pill on your tongue. And like, you know, you hear stories about dudes getting like really violent because like they were inspired by that or whatever, but you know.
In one sense, doing that record made me realize that being in a band is sort of a responsibility. You know, even with Judge, we learned that too. You know, by the last Judge tour that we did in America, I mean, it was freaking nuts. It was like, you know, straight edge kids would come up to me after the shows and they'd be like, yo, man, we freaking beat the crap out of this dude in the pit that was drunk. And you actually see a dude that was like had his head broken open and you start thinking like, this ain't too cool, you know, and we're sort of causing this. And, you know, people are, you know, directly becoming inspired by, you know, the lyrics to do this stuff. And it's just, that side sort of left a bad taste in my mouth because, you know, in one sense, it was never supposed to, you know, be like that. Anyone that like, knew us, anyone that knew Walter, he wasn't gonna fuck anybody up as fast as to fill out anyone's tongue, you know.
We're definitely sincere about the message, but I mean, you know, we're all pretty peaceful dudes. There was a sense of humor about it because if you know any of us and if you know Porcell, like, you know, we're light and, you know, just nice, chill guys. And again, like, the message was, like, sincere and it was coming from a real place, but it was sort of, like, it had a sense of humor about it.
Mike Judge loved it. Capo hated it. I guess those are just, like, the two kinds of people there. One guy's a real sort of dark guy and the other guy's a real kind of, you know, traditional posse-core dude. I mean, Capo hated it because it was sort of like, you know, the dark side of the force. But, in a sense, he was right because, you know, I mean, things definitely got way out of hand with, like, straight edge and violence. I mean, even before, like, the Salt Lake City thing. I mean, even, like, you know, during, you know, Judge, you know, it was first starting to get, like, crazy. Like, people were starting to get hurt. And it was like, you know, this isn't cool. But, you know, so I can definitely see where he was coming from.
You're gonna fucking tackle somebody and an X in their back because they're not believing the same thing you're believing in, then you've got issues either way. So whether it's inspired by Project X or, you know, Barry Manilow or whatever it is, like, it's gonna, you know, you're an idiot, man.
I mean, it's totally retarded, but, you know, I mean, the spirit behind it was fun, and I think that's why it ended up being a good record, is because we had fun making it.
I think that's what made that song, like, Straight Edge Revenge, you know, such, like, a cathartic thing that, you know, like, tons of people got into, is because, you know, to be straight edge around that time, you were taking a lot of crap. And so I think a lot of people could really, even though, you know, people might not necessarily, like, take it to heart and go out and beat people up, they could still relate to it in the sense that, you know, it was something that was on their mind, and after taking so much crap, he just wanted to get up there and sing that song, you know? So, in that sense, it was serious, you know? It was definitely a release to sing it.
I liked Crow. I liked a lot of those, you know, early bands, Reagan Youth and stuff like that. There's not kids, like, rallying around them soon, like, you know, like some new band plays and you don't know any of their songs and everyone stands there and then someone does a Reagan Youth cover and everybody goes nuts. I don't think that's happening anywhere.
Whatever reason, it seems like it's influenced a lot of kids over the years. I mean, for a while you couldn't go a show without hearing a Project X cover, or, you know, like, maybe that was more in the late 90s, but I mean, that's even 10 years later. I think that with Project X, I mean, it was just that record was something that stirred up a lot of shit. A lot of kids knew about it since then. I mean, it's been bootlegged a few times, but it was never readily available.
If you had told me in 1988 that people would give a crap about Project X in 1989, I would have said you were crazy. You know, it was never meant to be anything more than just like this, you know, free giveaway in a zine that, you know, whatever, just people would think it was like a cool extra to the zine. I mean, here that we're sitting here in like the year 2003, and that the EP is going to be, you know, repressed on this, you know, big hardcore label, and people, like, you know, still even, you know, give a crap. It really, like, blows my mind.
Yeah, I mean, they made, what, 500 copies of that record originally, and, you know, like, it's, like I said, it's been bootlegged a handful of times since then, but for whatever reason, it seems like it's had such a large impact, just because maybe it was the key players that were involved in the band, just like guys that were in, you know, all the big bands at that time in, you know, late 80s New York. Seeing as it's a record with, you know, a lot of the guys that made up the New York scene in the late 80s, but it was never really readily available, we thought it'd be cool to kick back money to the band that never saw anything from all the bootlegs that, you know, were made of it, and then have a legitimate release for them, you know, so that way kids that want to find out about them, you know, can pick it up.
But the fact that it was, you know, four people who were in other, you know, seminal bands from that era, from, you know, New York in the late 80s straight edge scene, the fact that it came with a pretty cool magazine, you know, that it had, like, a look about it that, you know, you could identify with and kind of get with and get excited about, it has the ability to be really powerful.
What we wanted to do was, you know, take the content of those issues of Schism, re-release them, I guess, in book form, kind of the way they do with comic books. You know, they'll take a handful of issues and put them all in one book, and you know, make it available again with the recording. I mean, every 3 or 4 years, a whole new crop of hardcore kids come in, and probably tons of kids that have never even heard of Project X. So hopefully, you know, it's our job to kind of reintroduce it to the new generation of hardcore kids.
Those were really like 5 songs, I think, that were like pretty specific about things that were going on in, you know, in our life. That scene at CBGB's with the shutdown show and you know, Cross Me. You know, Straight Edge Revenge was like part real and part, you know, fantasy. And that was pretty much the whole existence of Project X. It came from like a place of just like wanting to get this message across, and like we were proud of it, and that's what we were into. And like, you know, musically, we're just like into hardcore. We wanted to do this like super hardcore straight edge thing.
I remember being really excited about it. It's cool that people are still interested in it, and I hope they don't take it too seriously and kick someone's ass on the dance floor.
So, do you want to talk about the first release on Bridge Nine a little bit? Like, maybe just kind of...
Yeah, the first record on Bridge Nine, it's called Addiction. It's 6 songs.
I just thought it was funny. It came up with a few funny names. What was Alex?
He was Kid Hart, I believe.
Okay, yeah, no. beyond the obvious, I think that's about it.
Here I am, I have Kid Hart. And, you know, I'm not. I'm about the furthest thing from the truth, so. Right. Fucking ass. It's, you know, stupid. You know, hard being both an adjective to describe somebody's temperament and, you know, I think that, you know, it's also kind of comical, and that, you know, it could be taken as a, you know, double entendre.
Right.
You know, sexually or whatever. Complete bullshit. He's fucking high on Krishna food, I think. It had nothing to do with that.
Okay.
Maybe he was joking, I don't know.
I don't know, I just figured I'd ask you about it.
Did he say that it was...
He actually
He actually said you came in the room and it was your idea.
It was my idea, but he, I've never even seen that movie, so I don't know where he would have gotten that from.
Yeah, maybe it's just sensationalizing it or something.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, I'm it's shit. What was that done? I don't know, 15 years ago at least.
Right.
So I think that our memories are probably a little different at this point, and you know, who knows who's right.
Film this. I just gave the worst dive ever. All right. I'm not sure if it's on film. It sucks ass. I'm gonna make it up to the hardcore show. Just get ready. Double flip. Double front flip. Double back flip.
Not as good as Crucial Youth. You should do a DVD by Crucial Youth.